Thank you to WIW for having me here today. It's really an honor to share my experiences. I think I still have an imposter syndrome sometimes as to, like, is there something I've done really to share so much with others? But here I am. I started my career in 2003. I was very excited, armed with a degree in general management, technology and international business. I knew exactly what I was going to do, which was build a career in investment banking in the international financial markets. 18 years later, I have been working in media through and through. I am known for my understanding and expertise in digital advertising and digital publishing. And I speak more often on how to market to Gen Z and how to build international brands. And nobody in the financial circles even knows me. I think that's a pretty good example of how little we know. When we know everything. And there is this beautiful, there's this beautiful HR matrix called the Johari window. And it says there are four boxes. I know that I don't know, and I don't know that I don't know. I don't know that I don't know is our 20s, where we are officially allowed to make mistakes. And in the 30s, which is I know that I don't know, we learn from our mistakes. So that's where I am. I have had a brilliant run. I am very humbled at the opportunities that I've had. I've worked with some of the biggest media brands in the country and globally who decided to come into India. But I think what I've enjoyed most through my career, and I think that is the hallmark of what the last 18 years, is that I've thoroughly enjoyed doing what I do. And I think that really has been the one key element that has helped me achieve whatever little I have achieved so far and what I will, you know, probably get to in the future. As I moved from Australia to India for the consulting job, which was paying me 1/4 of what the fintech company was paying, and I was going through this I was undergoing serious pressure from home, where they were like, are you sure you know what you're doing? Just when we thought you were made of some metal and you were starting to excel and work, you've decided to come back and now you want to borrow some money from us to pay a deposit for your flat in Colaba. And I was like, yes, of course, I want to. I really think that this is what I can do. And I would like to do. And then the banking partner quits and I'm like, oh my God, I'm going to get fired from this role. And Thomson Reuters at that time approaches the company saying we're looking to evaluate whether India is a market for us to expand for a specific project. And as Ernst & Young was still starting up its consulting practice, they were like, is anybody here who has any experience in media tech? And I raised my hand so quickly. It's almost like that first venture in school, right? Like me, I will do this. I want to answer this question just to save my job. And the rest, as they say, is history. It was a lot of mentorship, a lot of good luck. Just the timing was right. India was rising. We landed up building one of the largest media practices in the country. And also, I think it was my first big step into the old boys club, as they put it. But I quickly realized that I needed to do this on my own terms if I had to survive. This was not a short distance running competition. This was a marathon which I wasn't prepared for. Like you'd be aware, it's extremely exhausting. The career in its initial years, you have absolutely no say on your time, the clients you get, the locations you travel to. I think from the age of 24 to 26, I went from having never traveled to any country to having traveled 26 countries. And while that may sound really glamorous, you can imagine what happens to the individual going through that. And I definitely had to pause at the age of 27. I took a 6-week break and I was like, this is not sustainable. right? And I need to decide what is it that's going to take me through the next decade or more. And the one thing that became very clear to me was I had to be myself to be able to enjoy and sustain myself. The one thing that has eventually, I think, been the core of my ability to keep moving forward and solving problems in my work and home is that I don't really distinguish between the person I am at home or at work. I just bring the same Chanpreet to work as I do at home. They are completely in completely synchronized with each other. And I think that is what makes all the difference. If you look at any successful person in the world at any level, whatever you define success as, whether it is a homemaker who's been able to build a beautiful, harmonious family, or whether it is a global CEO, or whether it's a head of state, you know what's one thing that's common is that they effortlessly move between their home and at work. So what do? You build an ecosystem that works for you. You build an ecosystem that recognizes that what you bring to the table as an equal partner is as important, and which cannot be just defined in terms of money or just in terms of being the primary caregiver to a child or being the emotional support to a spouse, but it's the whole package. And that's why sharing responsibilities as you go expand into your 30s on co-parenting or educating your mentors and your peers about who you really are and what your limitations are. You know, there is no need for you to hide behind this predefined persona of what is professional just because the industry has defined it in a certain way. For you don't need to take any pressure on yourself. You just need to bring your true self to work and it starts to fall in place. And I think that's been a very hallmark of my journey after a very successful stint at Ernst & Young and also then moving on to Formula One, where we brought Formula One into India as part of Ernst & Young with JP Circuit. I eventually had, I dabbled with a couple of entrepreneurial stints, which met with limited success. And then I moved on to Times Internet, where I led revenue strategy and eventually led Vice into India. I think the two things in my entrepreneurial journey which I would love to share are, I think it's time to accept failure when you do fail and move on. Because if you don't move on, that will be true failure. And the second most important part is the strength of your team, which is your co-founders or your investors. I think it is really important to choose your team well. There will always be disagreements. There will always be very high pressure points. But at that time, if you have the trust in your team, you can push it forward. And I think these are the two most valuable lessons that I learned and came back into the corporate sector, because when I did come back, it was a completely different person. You know, the high pressure of time is frankly just in your mind. And I don't know how else to say it. There is no pressure if you choose not to engage in it. And I understood that when I went back to the corporate world, and I think I had and this time when I went back to the corporate world, I had two children. My previous stint till then was no children, travel as you will, extremely supportive family, like go live your life, live life queen size. This time I came back, I had two children, I had a lot of responsibility, and I did better. And I did better because I chose to do two, three things. One, I opted out of roles which were better paying, but required me to travel, because I knew I couldn't do that. I couldn't do justice to the work, or I couldn't do justice at home. Secondly, I chose to work in places which were very close to home. So even if I had to put in the 12 hours a day, I knew I could just switch over between home and work, and I was reducing just travel time. And the thirdly, and the most important, is I chose my bosses, man. Because if there was a boss who did not appreciate that I was a mother of two, then I don't think it was going to work. Because just the way you take it for granted that it takes you 2 hours to travel in Mumbai from home to work, you have to take it for granted that young kids fall sick, okay? And it is unpredictable. It doesn't mean I'm unprofessional, okay? It doesn't mean I don't take my work seriously. If I can't party post 6 p.m. because I have a young child at home, it doesn't mean I'm not serious about networking at my job. It's just inconvenient for the moment, right? And I was very lucky to have a friend who decided to give me this opportunity, and he became my boss in Times Internet. It's one of the most defining moments in my career after having two kids to then restart and then soar. And I really give him a lot of credit, and I'm saying it very explicitly. It was a man, not a woman, but I rarely find such empathetic bosses. This pandemic, or as many people like to call it, the Black Swan event, is going to have some very dramatic impact on our cultural behavior and consumption patterns, many of which are here to stay. To start with, adoption of edtech, adoption of e-commerce, adoption of digital news and information and media consumption habits, something that we had originally associated only with the millennials, only with the Gen Z, has now really penetrated and come into critical mass. I mean, just 3 years ago, Netflix was something that only the ultra-urban, ultra-modern young people were using. And now Netflix, Amazon Prime is being, and other OTTs like MX, Voot, all of these are being considered as mainstream, right? Regulation is changing around that. Pricing is coming into discussion, and just shows a trend. My client, New York Times, who we've been working with, and we were in a really good place because we landed up restructuring the pricing in India in early January, right? They landed up restructuring the pricing in India and for Asia in early January, have benefited dramatically from the pandemic. Last year, if I'm not wrong, New York Times globally was at 4 million paid users at the beginning of the year. At the end of the year, they were at 5 million paid users. It had been the best year ever. This year, they've closed with 7 million paid users across the world. So this is a very good example of how businesses who've been working towards remodeling their business approach in the wake of technology have benefited from this event. However, of course, it's a tale of two businesses, right? The print businesses have become a thing of the past. Like, just imagine that it's a thing of the past now, practically, right? It's unfortunate that it was so dramatic. But as Mark Thompson, the global CEO of New York Times, the former global CEO of New York Times had put it, he was like, it's when the Titanic hits the iceberg, it's not a matter of if, it's a matter of when, right? And so it's good to acknowledge as soon as you can that some things have changed, and they've changed for good. For example, we don't know whether schools, or how soon will schools go back to a full-time 5-day working week or 6 days as it comes. Maybe EdTech, school from home, plus a offline schooling model is here to stay. Same with the corporations. We don't know whether we'll all be going back to work or we're all going to be working from home. Companies like Amazon have already announced that they're looking at restructuring their approach to just 15% of office requirement, right? So there are certain trends that are evident culturally, and they're good for the environment and they're good for the economy in the long run. I think the one thing that has become pretty evident is that we are now entering a stage of climate change-led unpredictability. And I think we all need to realign what do we call sustainable business models around it as well. The one very strong trend that we are here to see in terms of advertising and digital media world is that this is our moment. Okay, I think there's no other way to say it. Especially in India, for every 100 rupees that we will see being spent next year, or every new 100 rupees that will come into the system, 60% of that will go to digital media. And I think in my company, Resilient Digital, what we are trying to focus on is that it again doesn't translate into just winner takes all kind of situation. We are really focused towards this is to help small publishers and smaller brands to see how we can leverage this moment to be able to build the right foundations for digital businesses, digital publishers, and even advertisers to make the most of this digital transition. Because this digital transition is going to be, if done right, going to build in more transparency, right? It is going to be the main platform where people engage in a multilingual environment. If you think that we've already seen the big players and they've established the trends, we are just scratching the surface right now. This is just, the story has just, is just starting to unfold in my perspective. So yes, what we can see is a lot of more digital content coming out, a lot of dollars being shifted to digital advertising, a lot of focus on health, environment, climate change, sustainable conversations. Just to take a children's category, because we work very closely with Parenttune, which is India's largest social platform for parents. There is a huge focus we are seeing from a consumer's point of view for moving to cloth diapers, because the pandemic created this shortage of supply and they realized that what can I do to start moving to something that is sustainable at home? That's on one end. And on the other hand, it's also brought in a newfound focus on immunity, preventive health measures. You know, something that we used to learn about from our grandparents and grandmothers, like you need to eat this to build immunity, you need to build that. It's all come back into the consciousness, and that's a good change, right? So all in all, I'm very hopeful for the future. And I think this is our moment to start building out some very robust SaaS businesses and digital publishing businesses. And see, if we are at the cusp of seeing a dramatic growth for digital advertising as well. Yes. I just want to dial back on this question and say, take you back to what is the corporate structure right now. It actually originates from the Industrial Revolution, and the Industrial Revolution actually built structures meant for, which was suitable for white men who had a good ecosystem to take care of their homes, you know, with nannies and the homemaker and children, and all they were expected to do was go to office, work, come back, and everything was taken care of for them. And it's something that the whole world born, right? It's no one's fault. So when you go in as a leader, as a woman leader who has chosen to have a family, build its own ecosystem around it, at the very starting point, you are at a disadvantage because the system wasn't built for you, right? I think there are two things that I have experienced, which I would love to share, which help a lot. One is empower your team members to take a step forward and go beyond their own abilities and take ownership of what they do for you. And the second is to have a very strong co-parenting ecosystem, sharing responsibilities of parenting with your partner, with your entire ecosystem. You know, it's a very old saying worldwide, from Italy to India, that it takes a village to raise a child. Let the village raise the child, right? Let them do it for you. You don't have to be a superwoman. You don't have to be the best ever. And I would say this with a lot of sense of responsibility, that the best leaders are not the ones who lead by technical knowledge. They are not the ones who lead by putting in all the hours. They are the ones who lead by inspiration and insight. Have the insight, be passionate about your work, empower your team members, you know, have co-parenting responsibilities. And the one thing that in the end really helps a lot is build your own network of friends, of well-wishers, because there will be many moments of self-doubt. You know, in this era of social expression, where every high point and the only points that are expressed are high points, it's very easy to forget that your entire journey is actually riddled with self-doubt 80% of the time. And it's okay. Even the most successful people, in fact, the most successful people have executive coaches. Why do you think they have executive coaches? Because there are moments of self-doubt. And it's a very lonely place. And we understand that it is not possible for a team member to help you who's her boss in a moment of self-doubt. But there are people who are there to help you. So just because you have self-doubt, just because you have failed, doesn't mean you're not good. And the one last point I'd like to say is that just because nobody else has ever done it before doesn't mean you can't do it. Just because it sounds bizarre because of the gender that you are coming from or the color that you are coming from or the region that you're coming from doesn't mean it's not okay. Yeah. So hang in there, be steadfast and don't give up. There's no age for learning. You know, when you start off in your career and you've just gotten out of college, you're armed with degree and you're armed with a lot of energy to learn. And your 20s is when you actually get to learn a lot. You get to make a lot of mistakes and you learn from your mentors and your peers. But as you go older and you are starting to now evolve and learn from your mistakes, many people make the mistake of closing their doors on learning because they just want to work from a point of strength. That is your eternal mistake. If I were to stop learning in my 30s, today I wouldn't know anything of what my industry is doing. It's most important to keep learning, and what you learn from the junior most team member may be far more valuable than what your mentor taught you 10 years ago. Mentors teach you a lot about experience and how humans work. But there are a lot of innovations, ideas, and freshness of perspective that continues to come through, whether it is from the junior most team member or a peer or somebody from a cross-functional team. When I decided to quit a very high-ranking corporate job and take up a research fellowship at Oxford, at the Reuters Institute, Oxford University, I remember one of my closest friends and a mentor saying, "Are you mad? Who does this?" And I'm like, okay, so what's the cost? Let's just discuss it in the terms that we understand. And he made a very valid point. He said, "Chanpreet, you're going to lose momentum." Yes, yes, I did lose momentum. I am not saying I did not lose momentum, but I gained insight. I gained friendships from all over the world. I gained a learning, a strength of network of learning, which will never fail me. The Chanpreet who went to Oxford didn't come back. It's a different person. I suddenly feel like I'm a part of a global community from being a part of an Indian community. And I'm so grateful for that. Today, if I want to understand what's happening in Latin America or what's happening in Croatia or what's happening in Australia, it's a phone call away from me. Today, I draw from perspectives of some of the best thinkers across the world and not just India. And I don't think this can be evaluated with another 1 year in a job. It's a lifetime. So many a times you will make unconventional choices. You need to have the courage to go through with it. Do not expect the world to understand.